The government of the Democratic Republic of Congo is facing three of the world's deadliest viral infections at the same time. The country announced recently that a new outbreak of Ebola virus was in Wangata Health Zone in Bandaga in Equator Province. This comes as the country is also battling COVID-19 and the world's largest measles outbreak. At least six Ebola cases were recorded in Wangata, of which four had died in June. Three of these six cases had been confirmed with laboratory testing. The country's health ministry said at the time that it was likely that more people were infected with the disease. This is the Democratic Republic of Congo's 11th outbreak of Ebola since the virus was first discovered in the country in 1976. The city of Mbandaka and its surrounding areas were the site of the DRC's 9th Ebola outbreak, which took place from May to July 2018. The Democratic Republic of the Congo's 10th Ebola outbreak in North Kivu, South Kivu and Ituri provinces was in its final stages. On the 14th of May this year, the Ministry of Health began the 42-day countdown to the declaration of the end of that outbreak. The Democratic Republic of Congo is prone to new Ebola outbreaks given the existence of the virus in an animal reservoir in many parts of the country. Well, to discuss this further and the general state of the health system is the Democratic Republic of Congo. We are now joined via Skype by the World Health Organization's operations lead in that country, Dr. Maury Keita. Dr. Keita, very good evening to you. Thanks for joining us. Welcome to the Globe.
Okay, thank you so much.
Take us through which areas are the hardest hit and in which parts of the DRC are the worst affected.
We have currently seven health zones affected, but the health zone of Bikoro remained the most hotspot in this time.
Well, in terms of the figures, what are we looking at? I mean, how many people have been infected already and how many people have died, if at all?
In terms of figure, we have already 59 cases in total, 55 confirmed and 4 probable. We have already 22 deaths in total.
Let's talk about the response in dealing with all three major pandemics. I mean, the COVID-19 is already gripping the whole world, and now the measles outbreak. How prepared was the country to contain the measles outbreak?
In the area of Equator Province, we are not facing a measles outbreak here, but we are facing the COVID-19 and the Ebola outbreak.
So how is the country's health system coping with all this at the moment?
At the moment, I think, DRC has capacity on the ground. This is the 11th EVD outbreak in the country. So it's just it should be remembered that this epidemic was detected in Bandaka by a local staff who was trained during the previous epidemic. So they have capacity, they have staff on the ground, even WHO has already deployed more than 80 staff on the ground to support the MOH. So we have staff and capacity on the ground to respond properly to this outbreak.
So is the country receiving any outside assistance, for instance, from global agencies like the World Health Organization?
Absolutely. WHO is on the ground to support the MOH to respond to this outbreak, specifically in the area of surveillance, laboratory, IPC, risk communication, case management, safe and dignified burial and coordination. But as you know, Ebola is now a disease that can be prevented through vaccination and treated with new molecules that have shown their effectiveness. However, despite the effort that has been made in terms of community engagement, we are facing to some challenges in terms of contact displacement, in terms of logistic challenges. The COVID context is also another challenge in the province. This context is both an asset and also a risk because it limits the movement of people in to big cities. But with the economic impact on households, it can be also a risk to contribute to the movement of the population in the small market.
The WHO has in the past raised concerns about people not adhering to, you know, certain health protocols, such as refraining from touching bodies of the deceased during, you know, certain rituals. So have these concerns been addressed?
Yeah, we are on the field. We have some challenges, but I cannot say that this concern is addressed properly. But we are on the field to support the MOH to address these challenges. But we need funding. We need funding to overcome all these challenges. WHO need more than at least 9 million to support properly the Ministry of Health to respond to this outbreak for the next 3 months.
You know, in as much as you are, you know, all out in trying to contain this virus, but in the case of dead bodies, I mean, you certainly cannot expect people to turn their backs on their cultural beliefs, such as being in contact with the deceased bodies. When you say you are addressing that, to what extent will this stretch?
We are working with local leaders, community leaders. We have taking into account community culture, but we are also we need some support from the political side to explain and to accept to be to move population to accept our intervention in terms of safe and dignified burial. But by testing all the bodies, we will be able to make differences between confirmed cases and suspected cases or non cases. So in case with bodies is tested negative, community can do the normal burial.
What would you attribute the persistence of this Ebola virus to, I mean, in the DRC? Why is the DRC so vulnerable to these constant outbreaks?
It's mainly because of the geographical and the ecosystem condition.
And then measles?
Measles, it can be the same situation because of the geographical situation. We are not in the same, and the local culture, and because of, you know, as you know, Ebola is zoonotic, and before being transmitted human to human, so it's it can be related to population, culture, and the geographical and the ecosystem.
Well, the UN agency called for a scale-up in support to ensure that the affected communities are provided with all the key services, such as health education, such as vaccinations. And we do understand that 12,000 people have already been vaccinated in the 6 weeks since the outbreak began. Are you at all impressed with the numbers of people being vaccinated yet, given the large numbers of the population in the DRC?
Absolutely, absolutely. We were prompt in terms of vaccination, and we are continuing to vaccinate contacts and contact of contact and probable contact and frontline workers. So we are confident that we can stop properly and rapidly this outbreak by vaccinating more people.
So what's your analysis then of the different response teams? Because COVID-19 needs a totally different response mechanism. Measles requires a different response mechanism, and as well as Ebola. So is the country better capacitated to deal with all the response programs of these pandemics?
It's difficult in the context of COVID, but the country needs some support from other agencies, of course. But the country has already experiences in the COVID response, in Ebola response, in measles response. So they have capacity on the ground, but they need support from all the agencies to rapidly control these outbreaks.
So given the topographic or the geographic landscape in the DRC, just how difficult is it getting some of the medical supplies into the affected communities?
Absolutely. Specifically in the region where we are working now, we are facing logistic challenges related to the geographical context. We need some time to take boat to access to most of the localities. Most of area have no phone access, so teams need to be equipped with a sat phone. So it's in this context, it's very difficult to provide all the material in time, and because of some time, because of the weather, because the situation is a little bit very complicated in terms of access.
And now the WHO has asked for help in fighting the growing Ebola outbreak. Insofar as responses, how far has the WHO gone there?
Yeah, as I have already said, WHO is on the field. We have already deployed more than 80 staff on the ground responding to this outbreak, supporting the Ministry of Health. But we need more funding. We have to be prompt. As you might know, in health emergency, time is very important. So West Africa and Eastern DRC experiences teach us that a single neglected transmission chain moving into a susceptible area may easily get out of control if we did not respond properly and in timely manner.
All right, Dr. Keita, thank you so much for your time.
You are welcome.
That was the WHO's organization operational lead in the DRC, Dr. Maurie Keita, joining us via Skype.